Revelation chapter 21, and I begin reading from the first verse. And I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, "Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their God. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow, nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away." And he that sat upon the throne said, "Behold, I will make all things new." And he said unto me, "Write, for these words are true and faithful." And he said unto me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give unto him that is athirst of the fountain of the water of life freely. He that cometh, rather overcometh, shall inherit all things, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son." We'll end our reading there. I'm sure you'll agree with me that we have had a feast over the last few days as we have looked at the church beyond the obvious that we see. Often, as we mingle with Christians in the context of the Christian church, we tend to be carried away with the negatives. That guy over there who often irritates me. The other individual who was gossiping about me last week or the week before and consequently hurt my feelings. That other individual that I did not agree with when he led the Bible study. And so on and so forth. And maybe that lady whose child tends to cry so much just when I'm enjoying the sermon. And in the midst of all that, we lose sight of the glory and beauty of the company of God's people making their way to heaven, known in ancient writings as the church militant. So to come away from what is normally that kind of context and spend some time looking at God's holy word, thinking about the spiritual essence of the church, its holy communion, its mission in the world, its worship as it ought to be carried on before we mingle with holy angels in heaven, to think together concerning its composition and its holiness has been indeed a grand feast. In this last session, we are looking ahead at that event when we shall finally be in union with our beloved bridegroom, the Lord Jesus Christ. This is the Christian's blessed hope. It is when we think about that event that a lot of what we have been learning as demands upon us in this life as the people of God begin to make sense. In fact, we begin to sense within our own souls inspiration to keep away from the agenda of the world, to be a people separated unto God when we think in terms of that final meeting that we are scheduled to have with our bridegroom when we are united with him in heaven. What a glory it will be. Reminds me many years ago when the librarian in our church, not the church that I'm pastoring, but the one I was in previously, was scheduled to get married, and the wedding was getting rather close. I wanted a book from the library. And when I went to her and said, "Look, please, I've searched, I can't find this book. Can you help me?" Her answer was, "Conrad, look at me. I'm getting married soon." In other words, whatever can be postponed, please let's postpone it. I've got important business on my hands. I think we ought to respond something like that to the world when it wants to fill our trucks, as it were, with so many empty nothings. We ought to say, "Look at me, I'm getting married." In handling this event that we await, the bride of Christ being united to the bridegroom, there are a number of ways that I could have approached it, and I have decided to deliberately go to this passage that we have looked at because it captures something of the wedding motif that the Bible often uses here and there with respect to the second coming of Christ and his church moving in such a way that it is united with the Lord. He himself used this picture in a number of parables that he gave when he was still on earth. He would speak in terms of the kingdom of God being like a king who put together a wedding feast for his son. He would speak about individuals that the owner of the feast would come in and find not wearing the appropriate apparel. And he would ask those that attend this event to usher him out because he is not appropriately dressed. Again and again, our Lord spoke about his coming in this way, that there would be wise virgins and unwise ones, and when the bridegroom comes, the unwise ones would be locked outside because they did not have their lamps with appropriate oil. So clearly, it is a picture that the Lord himself has used many times, and we find it in this penultimate chapter of the whole Bible, in Revelation chapter 21. Since God himself uses it, let us think together concerning that picture as we come to this last address. The book of Revelation is not an easy one. The previous chapters have been full of different pictures concerning history, concerning the work of God, concerning the enmity of the evil one, concerning nation after nation rising against the people of God, the church of God. But once you realize the reason why it was written, then it enables you to go through all these difficult pictures, at least with a right compass. It was written primarily to encourage a persecuted church. John himself, the author, is one that was on the island of Patmos primarily as a place of momentary security from all the enmity that was taking place on the outside. And so God gave him these various revelations in order for him to encourage the people of God across the ages who would still remain under this malice of the devil and the malice of this fallen world. And clearly, therefore, it makes a lot of sense as you draw towards the end of this book that you should now have a triumphant and glorious ending. Because ultimately, that's what makes the battle worth it. It is when you hear the final trumpet. The battle is now over. You are on the triumphant side. Victory is yours. All the nights spent in the trenches, all the wounds upon your body, all the bullets whizzing past your head were well worth it. As you now march on home together with the rest of the triumphant throng, knowing very well that you are marching in victory. Well, that's the picture that perhaps ought to have been used here. But no, the picture that is instead used is that of a grand wedding. The bride of Christ coming home. There's a lot in common between that and the picture of warfare that we've just spoken about, and I want us to think concerning that for a moment. You see, the uniting of Christ's bride to her bridegroom is something that the church, the bride, continues to look forward to with intense longing. It's the same intensity that obviously you see with any soldier in the battlefield putting up a gallant fight. It's longing for the moment when they will hear the final surrender and know that we can now put our arms together and go home. It is the longing for victory. Well, that's what we find here in this passage of Scripture. First of all, it is captured for us in these negative words in verse 1. He says there, I saw a new heaven and a new earth. And then listen to this. For the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. Clearly, it is referring to something that if you are a true child of God, you long to see happening. The passing away of the world as we know it now. Why? Well, we are told in verse 4, aren't we, that this world is characterized by tears and death and sorrow and crying and pain. That's what this world is all about. Our children are born into this world crying. They continue through this world shedding tears. That's been part and parcel of our lives as we've continued through this life. And finally, we must end our last breath with a sigh that takes us out of this world into the next. We have known tears. We have known sorrow. We have known suffering. We have known crying. We have known pain. We have known death. This has been the common lot since Adam sinned against God. And the Lord pronounced upon our first parents that this world would be a period of trial, a period of pain. Thorns and thistles would be part of our lives until we return to dust. For dust we are, and to dust we must return. But for us as God's children, this is aggravated because of our fight against the world. The world's enmity, which invariably persecutes believers. I'm sure you have heard your lot as part of Christ's bride. When those who ought to love you having instead made you the target of their enmity. When you have known persecution in your workplace, in your city, in your town, in your country, or wherever else you might have been, simply because you are a Christian. You haven't done them any harm, but because the glory of God rests upon you, the evil one has used them to make your life on earth a living hell. As if that were not enough, there has also been your own fight against sin. We were hearing something of this earlier on with respect to our fight for holiness. I'm sure you know what I'm speaking about. Something of the cry of the Apostle Paul in Romans chapter 7. When he says he has the desire to do that which is right, but what he finds taking place within his own soul is that which is wrong, until he cries, "Oh, wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from this body of death?" Surely, therefore, we cannot wait for the former things to pass away. We cannot wait for that to happen. And many a time, alone in the darkness of our own bedrooms, upon our own beds, we have asked God questions. Lord, why this? Lord, why that? Why isn't this door opening? Why is this door shut? Why are you allowing these things to happen to me? And often, we haven't heard the answers to those questions. We long for the answers. And on this day, and in this period, the answers will be ours. But there's a positive reason why the bride of Christ longs to be united with her bridegroom. And it is because she lives every day with an absentee savior. You see, Christianity is not a religion of rules in terms of simply wanting to know what should I do, what should I do, and what should I do. It is a religion of love. In other words, it is that inner affection that causes us to want to obey the Lord, as we have just been told in the last session. The point is, it is affection. It is love that drives us as a people of God. As Peter puts it in 1 Peter, the first chapter and verse 8, "Whom, having not seen, ye love." If there's one proof that you are a child of God, it is this. That previously Jesus was some historical figure who once lived, perhaps you admired him at a distance in terms of his teaching, but now you know him, you love him, you've got a personal relationship with him. And like a bride, you long to see him face to face. And that's why our Savior, the Lord Jesus, before he left, he spent some time with his disciples in the upper room. He knew he was going away. But he wanted, like a bridegroom, to assure his bride that having espoused you, my departure is to go and prepare the matrimonial home. When I've done all, I will come again. I'll come to collect you so that you might be with me. So picture it. In the ancient Middle East, the bridegroom has now gone. What's happening in your soul day after day after day? You know he is there. Is this, when is he coming back? And with every succeeding day, the hunger, the pain of thirst in your soul can hardly be contained. You want to see him. You want to be with him. It's more than a running away from the world's persecution and hatred. It is, you love him. And you want to be in the presence of the one whom you love. Is that describing you? Is that describing your Christianity? So that picture of a bride beautifully dressed for her bridegroom is really the ultimate picture of why you long for the second coming. It's because you want to be united with him in this way forever. Well, the uniting of Christ's bride to her bridegroom is an event that will take place at the second coming of Christ. It is pictured here as the coming in of a new heaven and a new earth. I don't have the time to unpack the details of the biblical data concerning that second coming. Suffice it to say that it will be the wrapping up of history. The world as you know it now will cease to be. There's going to be a completely new era, a new world, a new dimension, captured in those words, a new heaven and a new earth. Yes. It will be a catastrophic ending. It's pictured over and over again in various ways in the prophetic writings and also in the words of our Lord Jesus Christ as he himself spoke in those final chapters, especially in the Gospel of Matthew. The point is that all human beings, great and small, will rise from the dead, be gathered before the great judgment seat of God, and there will be the great separation. The goats on one side, the sheep on the other. The goats will be all those that did wickedness in the eyes of God and died without repentance. The sheep will be all those that would have sinned against God aright, but whose names were finally written in the Lamb's book of life, in God's own providence, God's own decree, and all its outworking, therefore, across history. It is those who at some point in history turned from sin and trusted in the finished work of Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God. Those are the ones who will thus come into his presence, into what ends up being the marriage feast of the Lamb. I love the way in which it is captured in the words, they shall be his people and he will be their God. That is covenant language. Those who are in this covenant relationship with him, those are the ones that he will thus bring into this place. And you know what? History stands on tiptoe. Because it is in itself, in this pronouncement of the wrath of God subjected to decay, and recognizes that its own final freedom is tied up with the freedom of the sons of God. It stands on tiptoe, peeping as it were into the future, longing for its own liberty and longing for the day it will see the sons of God coming out of the woodworks, as it were, to rejoice in the presence of this God. John calls this the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God in verse 2. What a picture. I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God. Why this language? Clearly, it's because the temple, God's dwelling place on earth, was in the old Jerusalem. And you notice here that that's the emphasis. He says there, I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. Listen to this. And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her bridegroom. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them. There is the emphasis. In the old Jerusalem, that's where the temple was. That's where God's presence in a signal way was on earth. Now, God will, in this way, through his Son, unite with his people. There will be his very presence with them. I will dwell with you. You shall be my people, and I will be your God. That's what this is about. To be with him. To be with him. To be with him forever. Now, there's no doubt that part of the picture here has to do with an actual physical place. And so as you develop further in this chapter, you see John being taken to see this New Jerusalem. And he comes to a beautiful gate and wonderful streets and is amazed by what he sees. The whole place bedecked with wonderful jewels that make his eyes rejoice in the sight. There's no doubt about that. But again, if we look at that same chapter, we soon see that city is spoken of in terms of being the bride. Look at verse 9. And there came unto me one of the seven angels, which had the seven veils full of the seven last plagues, and talked with me, saying, come hither, I will show you the bride, the Lamb's wife. And he carried me away in the spirit to a great and high mountain and showed me that great city, the holy Jerusalem, descending out of heaven from God. So evidently, it's about the people, the church, the bride of Christ. It's about you. If you are a child of God. That's the other side to what we are seeing here. And it makes sense. Because ultimately God doesn't want to dwell in mere physical structures, however beautiful they might be. No, it's with his people, among his people, in fellowship with his people. The bridegroom wants to be with his bride. I'm sure that makes sense to you. He wants to be with his bride. Chosen from eternity, given to him by the Father. They were yours, but now they are mine. Purchased with his own blood upon Calvary's cross. Now to be with him forever. That's what love longs for. It doesn't long for provisions. It doesn't long for the property that the bridegroom gives. It longs for the person of the bridegroom himself. And so when the Bible speaks about this city having no need for light, the light of the sun, because God's own presence, his glorious presence, will provide the light. We all say amen to that. May the radiance of the glory of his presence with me light up my whole life. But what a sight it will be. Behold the scars. I don't know how we can do it. That in the midst of the brilliance of his glory, that the eye should behold him like a lamb that was slain. And oh, how the depths of the bowels of affections will pour out. As the eye beholds him who has loved us with an everlasting love. To behold him. To finally be with him. Eternity will not be enough. And to that I quickly turn. The uniting of Christ's bride to her bridegroom will usher in an eternity of comfort and an eternity of fulfilled aspirations. This is what is finally captured in those four verses, verse 4 to verse 7. Listen to this. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow, nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. And he that sat upon the throne said, Behold, I make all things new. And he said unto me, Write, for these words are true and faithful. And he said unto me, it is done. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. And I will give unto him that is athirst of the fountain of the water of life freely. He that overcometh shall inherit all things, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son. Clearly there is total comfort from all previous sorrows, all previous suffering, all previous pain. He himself, with his own hand, wiping away those tears. What a wonderful picture. What a wonderful picture. Child of God, you have known your dark. You have known those moments when you have cried yourself to sleep. When the question, why has drenched your pillow? The Lord has bottled up those tears. When you see, tears will be wiped away. Providence will make sense. Comfort will fill your breast as it never can on this side of eternity. Where there was sorrow, there will be joy. A joy that is indescribable. A joy that if you had in this world would completely destroy you. It will be too much for your soul to contain. But they, in the fullness of your redeemed humanity, you will be filled with that joy. And for that matter, for all eternity. Then there will be total satisfaction. For who hopes for what he already has? Who? They, your aspirations will be fulfilled. They, all your longings will be fulfilled. The current battle with indwelling sin will be no more. You will love him with an unsinning heart. Don't you long for that? It will be yours. He gives us a picture there, doesn't he, of drinking from the fountain of life. Fountain of the water of life freely. It's as though the fire hose has been opened and it's gushing out at you. Gushing. The soul is full to overflowing. That's the day that's coming. That's the day that's coming. Spurgeon captures something of this, and I'll quote him. It's a slightly lengthy quote, but you'll appreciate why I have preferred to err on the side of length. The glorified weep no more, for all outward causes of grief are gone. There are no broken friendships. Poverty, famine, peril, persecution, and slander are unknown there. No pain distresses. No thought of death or bereavement saddens. They weep no more, for they are perfectly sanctified. No evil heart of unbelief prompts them to depart from the living God. They are without fault before his throne and are fully conformed to his image. Well may they cease to mourn who have ceased to sin. They weep no more because all fear of change is past. They know that they are eternally secure. Sin is shut out and they are shut in. They dwell within a city that shall never be stormed. They bask in a sun that shall never set. They drink of a river that shall never dry. They pluck fruit from a tree that shall never wither. While eternity endures, their immortality and blessedness shall coexist with it. They are forever with the Lord. They weep no more because every desire is fulfilled. They cannot wish for anything that they do not have in their possession. Eye and ear, heart and hand, judgment, imagination, hope, desire, will, all the faculties are completely satisfied. On earth, we see it happening to a bride on her wedding day. If you've been with her for the last few weeks and months, working towards that event, now there she is in white, next to her bridegroom. The pronouncement has been made. She looks him in the eyes and says, I am yours, you are mine. That's only a shadow, dear friends. A shadow. This is the real thing. When you and I will look into that face and say, I am yours. You are mine forever. I want to close with just two quick pleas. First of all, it's a question. Will you be a part of this? Will you? Because if you are not reconciled to Christ, if he is not your Savior, if you die in your sins, the exact opposite will be true of you. The exact opposite. Instead of the fulfillment of your aspirations, you will be in the place where the worm dieth not, where you must cry and weep forever. Indeed, instead of the end of your sorrow and suffering, that would have only begun in the flames of hell. So I plead with you, flee to Christ. Flee to Christ. Experience his full and free pardon and cleansing through the blood that he shed on the cross. Now you may be saying, look, the sinners are out there. Those of us who've come here surely must be saved. That's my hope. That indeed is my hope. But I've been a Christian long enough to know that among God's people are often conscious and unconscious hypocrites who still need to close in with Christ. And oh, if you are here and Jesus has continued to be that distant figure, that distant teacher, close in with Christ today. Know him in a personal way as you experience something of his full and free pardon. But I also want to close by a plea to believers. Because as John puts it in one of his epistles, 1 John chapter 3, he who has this hope in him purifies himself, just as he is pure. In other words, this grand final picture ought to inform your present day life. Isn't that where I began when I spoke about that librarian in a former church who said to me, hang on, look at me. I'm getting married. That's really what ought to happen to us. That final union with the bridegroom, when we meet with thousands upon thousands and tens of thousands times tens of thousands angels in holy assembly, when we meet, to borrow more modern language, with millions upon millions and billions of believers right across history, may that inform our lives now. In other words, enjoy true spiritual communion with the living God and with his people. Seek him in true holiness of life. Begin to tune your voice in the true worship of God now. Praise him, worship him, thank him, knowing that pretty soon your own voice will join together with all these myriads to sing his praise. I say, do his work now. Fulfill the mission of the church now. Refuse to be asleep in the background. No, the bride has work to do. Throw in all your effort, throw in all your resources until you hear the final blast of the archangel's trumpet. Do your part. It will make that trumpet sound all the sweeter when you hear it. And may I also therefore say that in the midst of all this, may God help you to love him more. Love him more. Before he left a meal. And that meal drew our attention to the price. The body broken for you. The cup, the blood. Oh, brethren, as a bride awaiting her wedding remembers that moment when the groom with a ring on his fingers said, I love you. I love you. Be mine. May your own heart and mind make that trip to the cross regularly, frequently. Have a well-beaten path there. And see his love for you. Let it melt your heart. And let it cause you to say, Lord, I can't wait to finally meet you. Be united to you and to be with you forever. Oh, brethren, may that be our journey as we go as his bride to meet our bridegroom. Amen. Let's pray. Oh God, our Father, You have truly loved us with an everlasting love. We confess that often in the midst of the strife, in the midst of the raging seas, in the midst of the fierceness of indwelling sin, we lose sight of that love. But Lord, thank you for those final chapters of your compiled book of love letters to us. Thank you that there you show us that we belong to the winning team. That soon and very soon, the trumpet will be heard. The battle will be over. And out of the woodworks will come the ransomed throng with singing and everlasting joy upon their hearts and upon their lips. All we ask, O God, as we part from this place, is may we be among that number. For Christ's sake, amen.